Thank you very much. As Toby said, thank you very much, Toby. You know, it's always a surprise when lawyers have something good to say about judges. So as Toby said, I was elected president of the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda by the other 18 judges. You can imagine how swollen my head was, until one of them said, "We elected you because you're a woman and we know you will work very hard." So one of my first tasks as president of that tribunal was to go and deliver key addresses before the UN General Assembly and the UN Security Council. And when I was at the UN Security Council, one of the journalists came up to me and said, "Can I have a copy of your speech?" And I said, "What speech? I didn't prepare anything." And he said, "How can you come to the Security Council without a written speech?" So I thought, the CJA audience couldn't be more intimidating. So no speech. I had 22 hours to get here, but I have 6 minutes to speak. You're lucky it's not the other way around. I have followed over the years the work of CJA, and mainly from glowing reports from my friend Jane Rockamora, who's on the board. I felt I had to come and see for myself. Which I did. I spent a whole day with the staff, the colleagues, and with the chair. And I'm truly impressed, obviously, with all the work they've done. The CJA has almost an identical mandate and goals as does the High Commissioner for Human Rights. Because the crux of the mandate of the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, and remember, it's a powerful mandate given to the High Commissioner by all the member states to be a strong voice for the protection and promotion of human rights and the right to development. And we watch out for accountability, for justice, for values, norms and principles, and with the goal of building democratic institutions. And this is what CJA has been doing, and very, very successfully. So congratulations to them on that work. Now, what is the importance of addressing accountability and justice? Justice is, of course, a human right of every individual. It is a right. So they hold this right, but how is it ever translated into reality when there's lack of implementation? In other words, victims and survivors have a right to justice, but no access to justice, unless there are lawyers who would champion their cause and argue their cases. And that's the importance of CJA legal advisors, professionals. I'm truly impressed that they work with a wide network of human rights defenders in the field, that they have expertise and skills that they share with others in the field. So it's really a collaborative effort. And accountability is obviously important because it underpins democratic institutions. If you don't have justice and accountability and impunity reigns unchecked, that's a permanent factor for destabilizing society. For sustainable development, for stable societies, you need to address and bring to justice perpetrators of serious crimes. Otherwise, it undermines the entire legal system. That means everyone can resort to lawlessness and not respect the rule of law. Today, we are all so concerned by huge conflicts raging in several countries in the world. And that is a case of powerful leaders not complying with the rule of law and not complying with the framework of rules that they themselves adopted and said that they will implement. So in the wider context, this is the importance of addressing each case. And I said to CJA colleagues today, it doesn't matter if at the end of the day you win or not. The fact that you've brought this case helps victims all over the world. It shows that you care, exactly as the international community cared about the fact that we in South Africa were subjected to apartheid, institutionalized racism under the law. And you cared and helped to bring an end to that so that we've achieved democracy peacefully. So I'm not so familiar with the specifics of the cases done by CJA, so let me give you an example of my own. Under apartheid in the 1970s, people were detained and subjected to torture, and one of them was my husband. And we did not know how to challenge evidence in the courtroom that has been extracted under torture. In cases after cases under the Terrorism Act, this is how the police led witnesses. They kept them in indefinite detention without access to any lawyers. They brought them, and the accused were always shocked by the lies being spun by their former colleagues. And so in a case that I handled, I sought the help of the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law in Washington, set up by President Kennedy. And they sent to us a psychiatrist, Professor Louis Jolyon West of UCLA. So I'm telling this story to say how collaboration and sharing of skills is so important for those in the developing world who are struggling with these issues. We had Dr. West coming. He had interviewed very many American prisoners of war in the Korean conflict who claimed that the United States had used germ warfare when it was not true. So his job was to find out why these witnesses said what they did. And based on that experience, and also the fact that he was a state witness in the Patricia Hearst case, to see what had happened to her in detention. So he gave evidence on the DDD syndrome, dread, debility, and dependency. Now, we lost the case. Our goal was to tell the judge, you cannot rely on the evidence of witnesses who had been subject to torture and detention. We lost the case because the appeal chamber said, as you've heard in the Bush administration say, yeah, we don't torture people. We just use persuasive methods. So the court said we hadn't proved that our police, the South African police, had acted unlawfully. But they recognized Dr. West's testimony as expert testimony. And that proved very important for us to handle the next case. Now, the documentation we collected both in the case I did for my husband and this major case, we collected affidavits from many victims who had been subjected to torture. We had to prove a systematic pattern of torture conducted by the head of the secret police. His name was Colonel Roynick Swanhu, redneck. So truly he had veins there that frightened you. And he had reigned supreme for almost three decades. So we went to all the people in London and other places who had been tortured by him. We compiled this dossier. We lost the case, but these documents then reached the United Nations, where the anti-apartheid movement and the African National Congress used these documents to bring the issue before the General Assembly. And then what happened was that Stephen Biko was killed under torture. So they used that case. The ANC, who had observer status, used all the information we had gathered in the court case, Stephen Biko saga and asked for two things. One, that there be sanctions against apartheid South Africa. And they didn't get that because the United States and the UK used their veto to stop the sanctions. Now, the other relief they wanted is that the United Nations adopt a convention against torture. And that is our convention adopted. So our small case, because yes. And this is the part in which CJA and all its supporters are following, why we need accountability and why we need that macro result someday. And of course, CJA can't do its work to help victims to get access to justice if it weren't for you. The true heroes then are sitting in this room. You are the donors, the supporters, the moral and financial supporters of this work. You have followed your heart and your principles with the concrete help. So I want to pay tribute to you and to stress to you the importance of your work, not only in respect of the cases brought here, but how this is going to spread and help human rights defenders in the rest of the world. So thank you very much, and I will value this award. Thank you.